good now. I hope you're doing well. Thanks for joining me and welcome to this wildlife photography ASMR video, I guess we'll call it, where I'll be just a few moments. I'll be going over the some of the photos that I have acquired of various wildlife, mostly birds, using the newly acquired and my first ever zoom lens, the Sony 200 to 600 millimeter zoom lens, which I did an unboxing of back in May, and because I was making a switch from my previous camera, the Panasonic, and was going to go to maybe Canon, but I found out that Sony has a 200 to 600 millimeter lens, and for, I would say, 95% of my shots, I'm at the far end, the long end, this 600 millimeter end of the lens, and rarely am I down at the 200 or 300 or even 400 focal length, because most of the subjects are usually small birds. Most of them are far away, and so I need that extended reach. So I'm really, you know, I still own it. It's been over a month, so I haven't returned it. I'm quite happy with it, and I think it's going to be a great, I think it is a good investment, and I hope to use it for as long as Sony continues to make cameras. I usually go out on the weekends, once a weekend, usually on Sundays when it's less traffic because of the places that I have to drive to. Not every weekend, but, you know, maybe a couple weekends back to back. And I spend about 3 to 4 hours walking around and taking pictures of whatever I can find, which is mostly birds. I don't really live near or have access to things like, you know, mountain goats or coyotes, I know bears. I'm here in the mid-Atlantic region on the East Coast. It's mostly birds, deer, occasional fox, you know, maybe beavers or otters or things like that. But for the most part, it's mostly birds. Yeah. That makes up the majority of the fauna. I would like to travel, maybe, you know, go to Alaska, you know, once. We'll see about that. But I'm very glad, though, that I acquired the Sony 200 to 600 because, like I previously stated, I was thinking about the Canon 100 to 400, but the 400 wouldn't be enough reach, I'm just, you know, glad I got the Sony. There are some other manufacturers out there that make comparable lenses. Maybe, you know, you're looking to get into it yourself. There's options out there. I'm not sure if you are familiar, but there are lenses out there that cost almost $10,000. Those are lenses, they're much heavier. I don't really think you can carry them around and handheld, things like that, but I don't think I would ever own a $10,000 lens myself. I'm quite happy with, you know, the price tag, with the 200 to 600 being around $2,000. That's as highest as I'll go. So, and I also acquired a monopod with a gimbal head, so that it basically tilts up and down. Of course, I can turn the monopod so the lens and the camera can move horizontally, and it's got great stability. That was a little pricey as well, but it's lightweight. It's I think it's a composite and a material, and it just, you know, I can move the lens around, and maybe one of these days I'll do a video showing how, or I'll include some footage of showing how I use my gear out in the wild, but that's for another time. All right, so I think I've talked enough about that. Why don't we get into the photos of the different, mostly birds. There is one squirrel in here that I've acquired over the past month, and I'll share any anecdotal stories about them. So start, we're going to go alphabetically, pretty much by the name of the bird. So here we have a bald eagle in flight. This was my very first bald eagle in flight photo. This is a crop, so this is not the actual original image. So it's been cropped down a little bit, and as you can see, I think it's the camera does a great job, and I've also been getting used to. I've had to get acclimated to shooting at high shutter speeds. So I shoot at around 1/2000th of a second for mostly the birds in flight. Rarely do I drop down to a lesser shutter speed, maybe down to 1/1500th of a second, something like that, if there happens to be a bird just sitting around on a branch. But usually I keep it at around 1/2000th. And there's not that much noise. There is some noise here because I do a little bit of post editing in with the RAW format. So I add a little bit of sharpness. I don't really increase the sharpness in the camera. So this is a eagle just flying early in the morning, about 9 o'clock in the morning. And this just happens to be at one particular location called Bombay Hook in Delaware. And which has, it's a wetland marsh type of area, and I've seen like 6 eagles at least. I've never seen so many eagles in my life in one location. So now here is one of the, this was I think like my second outing with the camera, my second weekend with the new lens, I should say. And here on the right you can see bald eagle, and this was very high in the sky, so this is a heavy crop, so they're quite a distance away, and I'm still getting used to shutter speeds and things like that. So this is like my only second weekend with the camera, the new camera and the lens. But on the right you see the bald eagle, and on the left is an osprey with a fish, and the bald eagle is actually trying to get the fish from the, like I said, it's so far away. It's, I mean, this is pretty much the best that you can get from these images. They were really high up in the sky. But the bald eagle is trying to get the fish from the osprey over here. You can just barely see that. There's a little better outline profile silhouette of the fish, and the bald eagle closing in. Another photo, again, not the greatest, but you have to understand these were so far away that even for my 200 to 600 millimeter lens, you know, it was out of its reach. They were out of its reach. I mean, even if I had an 800, you know, millimeter lens, or however high they go, you know, maybe with a teleconverter, I probably could have gotten a little bit better, a little closer to them. And again, another shot, and the eagle still chasing. You can see its beak open there. after the Osprey. Is that the last one? Yeah, that's the last one. And so apparently I missed it because they're high in the sky and there was a tree between me and them. And I lost them for a little bit. And then I stopped photographing them. I really didn't know what was going on. I didn't have any binoculars, but someone who had binoculars told me that eventually the eagle did get the fish from the osprey. So I missed that. That would have been cool to have captured, but, you know, so but that was cool enough to see. This is one of the things, whether you photograph or you use binoculars, it doesn't really matter. Just being out in nature around some places that are active, you know, with wildlife, you just never know what you're going to see and get to witness some pretty cool things like that. Just, you know, being at the right place at the right time. And this was taken at one of my other favorite haunts. It's called John Hines National Wildlife Refuge, not far from Philadelphia, right next to the Philadelphia International Airport, to be exact. Okay, so we are back at Bombay Hook National Wildlife Refuge, and here is a little series of either there are two bald eagles. On the right is an adult. There's the adult, and on the left is either a juvenile male or female. Bald eagle males and females look identical. Just because the one on the left doesn't have the white plumage around its head, that doesn't mean it's a female. Unlike other species of birds where the male is more colorful, it doesn't really work like that with eagles, so I've learned. But the bald eagle on the right came flying, swooping in, and I guess the one on the left wasn't having any of it, or what, I don't know if they are related, but eventually they just, you know, had a little quarrel, a little spat, and they became best friends, tolerate one another. So that was a little cool little thing that I got to observe and witness there. Next are these barn swallows. So you can see on the left here is a railing. This is at John Hines, the refuge. And there is a body of water underneath. This is like a boardwalk that I am on, which enables you to walk from one side of the land across the water to the other side. And also allows you to, you know, take some photographs of anything that might be around the water. So it's really cool. And these barn swallows, for whatever reason, you know, I'm sure they're having a pleasant conversation right here. There, I mean, you can see how close I am. I don't know, like 5 feet away, something like that. If that, maybe even closer. There's a lot of them right around this. I think they might nest underneath the boardwalk here. And maybe they're just very acclimated to human beings, because as you can see here, it's just sitting there, not even threatened by me or any of us walking by. Another picture here. And this is what I love about the 200 to 600 millimeter lens, or any zoom lens. It's like having a microscope out in the field. I mean, just getting to be able to see all the details around the eyes, all the intricate details of the feathers and the plumage and all that. That's what I love the most. It's not so much that, oh, hey, it's a bluebird, or not a bluebird, a barn swallow. It's more like I like to try to catch them in there doing their behaviors, or just being able to see the details. That's what fascinates me the most. And then another, this was to my right. Again, just just sitting there, not bothered at all by me. And so here you can see a lot of the, just the intricate details of all the little strands of feathers. And the beak and the eyes, you might even be able to see me standing right there in the eye, pointing my lens at the bird and the boardwalk, and in the distance, the tree line. And of course, little bird feet. Where's little bird feet at? There we go. Some bird feet. So, just another shot of the bluebird turning its head. Not a bluebird, barn swallow. They look like bluebirds, very similar, somewhat. And basically, these birds are continuously flying around. Rarely do you find them stopping to perch on a branch. Occasionally, you will, but they're usually flying about. So I just got very lucky to be able to photograph them. This is a black-necked stilt shorebird. Basically, these birds just walk around in shallow water, feeding on whatever they find underneath the water, which I'm not really sure exactly what that might be. Small mussels and clams and things like that, what I'm thinking. Whatever kind of things live in the water. Maybe minnows, small fish. But this one is just had landed into the area. This is at Bombay Hook. Bombay Hook Refuge has a lot of shallow waters, more of a wetland, marshy type of area. There are some sections where some deep water, but a lot of it seems to be water that the birds can wade around in. And here you can see they just walk around looking in the water. Here's just the trail as it walks, some bumbles. Just another close-up of the silt or the mud from underneath the water, the reflection. Yeah, and that's it for the black-necked stilt shorebird, which I just learned. So that's another thing, when you start photographing things, like, what is that? And gotta, look it up and everything. This next series of photos is of a blue jay taken from my backyard when I started posting on Instagram and Twitter. Someone commented if I ever see any blue jays, because to that person, it's like their white whale. It's a very difficult or hard for them to find, and they always like to photograph it. And there are blue jays common out here where we live in the Mid-Atlantic region, but they are quite difficult to capture or photograph. They're not quite, you don't see as many, you might see one blue jay in your area. They're not like robins. You might see like a dozen robins in your area, but maybe rarely you'll see a blue jay. They are just beautiful, striking with the blue. It's funny they're not called bluebirds, but anyway, so someone made that comment if I've ever seen any blue jays, and then a couple days later, I had that comment in my head, and I was, trying to keep my eye out for some blue jays, and next thing I know, this male or female, I've never seen two blue jays together to know if the female looks different, so I'm assuming maybe, I don't know what a female blue jay looks like, but yeah, so this one just is flying up from the ground after. You can see it's got something in its beak there, maybe a bug or something, hard to tell. And then it's flying back up to the branches and showing off its nice plumage there. Just great striking colors. And there it is on the electric wire running to the house. Looks like a zombie bird there a little bit, because it has the, its eyelid. Just happened to snap a photo while its eyelid eye was closed, so to speak. And there it is on the ground looking for another meal. Back up on the branches as it keeps its eye onto the ground. Well, maybe it's looking up this way. Who knows? I mean, they look... Who knows which way the bird is actually trying to focus, right? I mean, could be down here. And of course, it has its other eye up that way. But, all right. So that's it for the blue jay. This is some of these purple flowers. I don't know what they're called. I'm not an expert when it comes to flowers. But I happened to notice that these particular flowers were having quite a lot of bee activity, and I noticed a couple bumblebees flying around, and so I did my best to try to capture some bumblebees in flight. So we got a little bumblebee butt right there. It's abdomen, I guess you would say. It's ideally, you would like to catch the head of the, you know, the front of the bumblebee, and not so much the butt. But hey, sometimes you gotta, you know, take what you can get, I guess. And it looks like there's some bits of pollen being scattered around there, but so that's this was kind of more of a test to see if I could use the zoom lens to take close-up shots of almost macro-like shots. So this was about, I don't know, 5 feet away or something like that. Yeah, I mean, it's not bad for macro type of capabilities. So this is almost something that you would be able to capture using a macro lens. You won't get too up close like you could with a macro lens, but no, it's not bad. Okay, so here is a little family of Canadian geese, and you can see there, I'm not sure which is mom or dad, but you can see the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 little ducklings, and I happen to notice them out, and this is at the John Hines refuge, and so this water out here is quite deep compared to the more shallow wading type of water at Bombay Hook. Like, for instance, where we saw the black-necked stilt bird. So I'm standing on the boardwalk that I mentioned earlier, where we saw the barn swallows. And I'm looking out, and I see these, you know, Canadian geese and the little ducklings. And next thing I know, they go to land. So I walked over to try to get some photos of the little ducklings, and I was able to. I'm very fortunate and lucky. They were down the bank of off the path where you can walk, and there were just they were all just feeding, and so very cool. I never got a chance to see the ducklings up close, and you can see it trying to figure out, I guess, what to eat, what not to eat. And I want to show you something here that you might not be able to unsee once you see it. Take a look at its beak and tell me that doesn't look like a crocodile's head. And so now all I can see is a crocodile almost emerging out of the duckling's face. Like, as if this... All right, that's the duckling's beak and its nostrils, but it looks just like a crocodile. And so now I'm just looking at this, and all I can see is a crocodile, like it's a parasite, like it's taken over the duckling, and it's the crocodile that's eating, emerging out of the duckling's face. But that's just, I can't unsee that now. But yeah, so there's the duckling eating some of the plant. No idea what kind of plant or weed that is. And there it is, trying to get some plant underneath the water. And just moments after, just raising its head back out of the water, and some water drops right there. And there is the duckling trying to determine whether or not that twig bent over branch is something worth eating or not. Not, of course. And here's some more of the ducklings on land as they try to figure out what to eat, what not to eat. There's mom or dad in the back. Again, ducklings. Brothers and sisters. Trying to take a little bite of that little weed or branch right there. That's a cute little picture, I have to say, with its head kind of tilted like that. And I can only think that it's probably looking down. Maybe that's why it has its head tilted, to get a closer look of whatever the heck it's looking at. And there's a close-up of mom or dad. I have no idea how to tell the difference between Canadian geese and I'm not sure if this is mom or dad in the back, but while the one other adult and the little ducklings were eating, this one was keeping watch, maybe keeping a watch on me. I wasn't that far away. I was about 10 feet away, something like that. Yeah, it really was just kind of standing there like that, just watching over everyone. So, and there's mom or dad taking a drink and raising its head out of the water with, I just love whenever, you know, can get something about drops of water, whether it's on a leaf or, you know, raindrops, whatever. I just love water, water. So yeah. And then this is the ever watchful mother or father, just, you know, making sure everything is okay. And there it is. You can see its webbed feet there. All little details, all the intricate details of the scales there. Reptilian, right? That's what birds are. Anyway, kind of, right? Part reptile. And there it is, another funny little shot there of the mom or the dad just keeping an eye out. Another duckling. And there's the whole gang. Well, that's half of the gang, at least. See their little feet there, webbed little feet. And just a couple more photos there. And there you can see one. It's got a piece of the little plant there. All right, next we have a common yellow throat, another bird that I recently learned what it is. And you can see here it is trying to, they eat a lot of insects, spiders, larvae, flies, pretty much any kind of insect like that in any its stages. And it's trying to, it got something in its beak just moments after. Maybe a little spider. You can see, looks like we might have legs or an antenna. Maybe the thorax and the head and then the abdomen. So I don't really know what it is. At first I thought this bird was eating little plant material, but looks like it got a bug. It's hard to tell exactly, but. And this is a common yellow throat. It either is a female or a young male. Hard to tell. The male common yellow throat has much more striking features, especially around its head. there it is. A little drop of water on its head there and its beak open, trying to, I guess, look for, acquire more bugs. And there it is, reaching out to, I guess, maybe see if there's a bug inside the hole of that little branch. And there it is again, reaching up, using its feathers to, I guess, balance itself as it tries to get something from the wood. Could be a termite. There it is, peeking out, trying to see what, you know, what am I doing exactly, probably. I don't know. Or it's just looking for more bugs. And you can see it's just hopping, kind of walking and hopping along the branches as it goes about its business. There it is again, trying to find more something to eat. And there you can see this is just after it got done hopping. This is just about to land. There it is, just resting for a moment, I guess, as it figures out where to go next. And that's it. And those were pretty much all shot at around 1/2000th of a second to be able to freeze the very active, quick-moving bird as it, you know, moves around. A lot of these have been adjusted using Adobe Camera Raw. So I shoot in RAW. My first outing, I had to get used to the file formats because, you know, it's been like 15 years since I shot in RAW. So I had to get acclimated to that again. And so a lot of these images, like here, might have been a little bit darker because it's in the trees, or, you know, the sun is not really blazing down and lighting up the area. But that's one good thing about shooting in RAW, is that you can bring out, you can lighten all of the shadow, you know, really kind of correct the photo. So it's a good thing about shooting in RAW. And these next birds are cormorants. They are a type of seabird, very reptilian-like in appearance, almost prehistoric-looking. They're kind of like ducks or geese, but not really. They do swim around in the water mostly, and they will dive under the water for their, you know, to obtain the fish, I guess, swimming around. But they have these amazing colored eyes, these almost like aqua blue, teal kind of eyes. They just look very, almost menacing. So there's just, I just happened to see a pair, and they were, and I'm assuming we have a male and a female here. Maybe this is the female, the darker one is the male. I'm just guessing. And just here's another photo of them, and they don't really do much but swim around. Here's another, there's a third cormorant, however you say it. But you can see these two look like a pair. And over here on the right, and here you can see an image of one of the cormorants as it is either about to dive, or I think it's just about to dive underwater. So whenever they do catch a fish, if anything, I'm not sure if they eat it and gobble it right up while they're underwater. But as I was watching these cormorants, I didn't see like anything in their beaks. So if they're catching anything, I mean, I'm assuming they eat it right up as soon as they, you know, catch it underwater. But they go under and then they disappear for a little bit and they come right back up, you know, like 5 feet away from where they were, something like that. So you can see this one is just might have just been underwater coming back up, or is, yeah, you can see the water. You can see the water dripping from underneath its mouth, and I don't know if that's a fish right there, maybe a cod. I can't really tell what that, there's its beak, and there's something right here, that's not its neck, I don't think, so I'm not sure what that is. And there they are again, just swimming around. This is my first dragonfly using the 200 to 600 millimeter lens, and what's good about capturing insects with a telephoto zoom lens is that you can, you know, sometimes like this dragonfly, I wouldn't have been able to capture it with a macro lens because I would not have been able to get that close to it. This was in the water, and just unable. And about, you know, again, you know, maybe 8 feet away, something like that. So I would not have been able to get this kind of close-up shot using a macro lens because I just couldn't get that close. I'm not going to go into the water. But so this is not bad for the 200 to 600 millimeter. You can see some nice details, and you do see some noise. This is a crop. Again, this is a somewhat of a heavy crop, and there is noise. Some of this is noise introduced in post, but I mean, when you're looking at it like this normally, you know, it's just fine for me. I don't really sell my photos or anything. I just like coming back and looking at the details or the behaviors that I've captured. So I just add a little sharpening, and then I try to keep the color of the image as natural. That's what I like, as if this is how you would see it if you were to, you know, I don't try to add it, make them look too fancy or anything like that. But yeah, so first dragonfly, hopefully of many more. Next we have an eastern kingbird, which I just learned as well. That's another thing when you start photographing or looking at birds with binoculars. You start to build up your own internal mental catalog. So, another bird that I think eats insects. And just a little bit of a closer, again, being able to see all the details. And its little claws there, its feet. Next, we have a little bit of a noisy image. I think I added too much noise, or sharpened it too much. But this is a snowy egret, and it just so happened to have been standing on this this piece of wood sticking way up out of the water, almost like a pier. I guess, I'm not sure why there was just this one piece of wood, but it was just standing there, resting or looking for fish to catch, but it was there for a couple moments, a couple minutes, and so I snapped that picture of it. Here is a snowy egret in comparison to the larger great egret. So you can see the difference there between the two. And a lot of other shore birds in the foreground and in the background. I think these are called plovers, but don't quote me on that. I think this is my first time seeing a snowy egret as well. These were quite a distance away, so even with the 200 to 600 millimeter lens, sometimes things are still out of reach for it. I don't use a teleconverter, but so that's that. Here is a great blue heron. That I happened upon. This is over at the John Hines National Wildlife Refuge, and I was on my way out, leaving for the day, when I happened to notice this gray blue heron, and I thought I would, you know, stand around for just a couple more minutes and see if I can catch it catching a fish. And lo and behold, again, just very lucky being in the right place at the right time. You can see it splashing down into the water. I just love the water spray, anything with water, water drops, rippling water, you know, just something about it. And there you can see, I think this is a type of bass, a rock bass, maybe, that it caught. And there you see a better look of the bass there, the fish, with right between the beak of the great blue heron. And there you can see it gobbling it down whole. Kind of like me whenever I eat, just, and now the whole fish is going right down the throat of the great blue heron. You can see if you look earlier, there's how thin the heron's neck is, and then once it has a fish in there, there we go, working its way down into its stomach. So that was cool. Oops, looks like we're out of order. I have a couple images here. It looks like these images are a little bit out of order, but no big deal. So there it is, the fish going right down there. And so that is just very lucky. These are the kind of National Geographic moments that I'm always trying to capture. I just, you know, I have a little bit of a nature documentary type of person inside of me. I'd love to be able to, you know, not every day, but, you know, love to be out there catching some really cool moments. So that's the great blue heron catching a fish. You could stand there watching them for, you know, 15 minutes and never catch anything, because they slowly walk and stalk their prey, the fish. And when they do, you know, jab their strike with their head and beak underwater, they don't always catch the fish that they're trying to. So I just happened to get very lucky that it happened within just a matter of minutes of me stumbling upon that gray blue heron. Okay, next we have a very, this is another cool, this is another one of these lucky moments I stumbled on. This is a female Baltimore Oriole, and it is in waiting for a male close by to court with it, to mate with it. So a little funny story here is I was walking down a path, and I saw this, like, somewhat orange bird, it is orange, moving around on the ground in the brush. And so I, you know, walked a little bit of a distance away so as not to scare it off. And it was this female Baltimore Oriole, and she had a strand of dried grass in her beak. And I thought maybe she's building a nest, or I don't know what's going on. And next thing I know, she jumps up, flies up onto this branch, and this male Baltimore Oriole shows up, lands on the branch, and the next thing you know, he is trying to court mate with her. And I'm not sure if you know, all right, that's over there, that's actually them, I think. It's almost the precise moment. I'm not sure if you are aware of this, but birds, they share the same type of reproductive organ. It's called a cloaca. I'm not really sure how to pronounce it. But it's it is one type of organ where they both reproduce from as well as expel any waste. Yeah, so everything happens out of one little orifice, I guess we would say. And yeah, so they, their cloacas will touch. I think they call it a cloaca kiss, if I'm not mistaken. I have that in my mind for some reason. They briefly touch, and the male passes along his reproductive stuff to the female, and that's how quick it happens. So I think that's somewhat similar to snakes, that which would make sense because birds, right, are evolved from reptiles and all that. So, but this was a very cool. I just sometimes I feel like the fates, quote unquote, are guiding me, and I just happen to fall right into these really cool moments that I've, you know, able to capture. And then he was done there, and then he flew away, and she's kind of left, you know, saying, "Hey, where are you going?" That's it. That's he just was, you know, he shows up, did his business, flies away, and she's kind of left, like, you know, "Wait, what? Wait, is it, are we, that's it?" I just feel like I can't help but dehumanize the situation and just her expression. Like, where are you going? Aren't we going to cuddle and spoon? Right? So that was a very cool moment. And of course, I also learned that they are Baltimore Orioles, which I did not know. This is a mute swan on a nest out in the wetland type of area at the John Hines refuge. And I'm assuming it's a nest. I mean, seems kind of obvious. And the swan has just been sitting there for minutes upon minutes. And I went back, you know, a week later, and it's still there. I don't know if it's the male or female. They take turns or whatever. But I don't think I'll ever get a chance to see the ducklings. I don't go every day. You know, if I visited every day, I would try to document when the little ducklings were born. But just another photo of it as it just kind of sits there and occasionally get rid of whatever might be in the branches, move the branches around or something. And you can see it's preening itself, getting rid of whatever bugs, I guess, might be in its feathers. And these are just a small little flock of mute swans flying from one location to another, I suppose. And another close-up of mute swan with some water drops dripping down from its beak after raising its head up from underwater, from feeding on whatever plant material might be underneath the water there. Love the rippling water. I could honestly just photograph just water ripples and reflections. Just something about it, almost mirror-like. It's great stuff just to watch the rippling water sometimes, the flowing water. There's just something mesmerizing about it. Okay, so this is an osprey, and another one of these lucky attempts, or lucky, you know, right place, right moment. So that boardwalk I was talking about earlier, we saw the barn swallows on the railing. So I'm standing here on the boardwalk, and there's an osprey. Normally these osprey are really high and far off, and really difficult to get this kind of close-up image, even with the 200 to 600, maybe even something greater. An 800 lens still might struggle, you know, even with a teleconverter, because they're just so high in the sky and so far off from land, really difficult to get close up. But this one was right above us, near the boardwalk, and hovering around. And just look at those legs and those talons. And I just kind of learned this year that they are osprey. Maybe I knew about that before, but here's another crop as it is using its wings to hover above the water as it eyes or looks for prey. And once it finds a fish, it will start going into this hovering mode, and then it will dart down. I did catch some photos of it diving into the water, but I wasn't expecting this. It happened so quick, so they're blurry, and they're just not good. But this is the osprey, just moments after diving into the water, and it's coming back up. So it's it almost looks like it's swimming, but you know, obviously it's not. And this is me trying to just, all this happened so quick, and I'm trying to get my lens and my camera lined up. You can see the water spray, and you can see it got a fish right in its talons right there, a little out of focus. You can see the focus is right in front, right about here. So my camera is trying to, you know, I'm snapping. I'm using the auto drive function of the camera, so it's photo after photo after photo in split seconds. And in split seconds is how quick this osprey is moving out of the water as well, with the fish that it caught. But here's a little bit better shot of the osprey with the fish that looks very surprised. What the heck is going on? yeah, but there is just a beautiful bird. And just another one of these lucky moments. There's a little bit better shot there. A little bit blurry, but again, I think that's a lot of me trying to move the lens and track it as it's starting to fly away. And there you can see it's lost its grip just a little bit. And you can see the claws just barely. I mean, the claws are not piercing, you know, they're not like dug into the fish, so they just must have scraped just enough, look at that, up to be able to hold on enough of the outside of the fish. I don't know how it's doing it. You can see all three claws, 1, 2, 3, so somehow it's able to hold on there. And a nice little look of the plumage and the feathers. And I think that is it. So, just very cool. That's another one of those once-in-a-lifetime kind of things, because it just dove down right in front of us. I mean, it was like, you know, 15 feet away, right next to the boardwalk, right in the water. And I just happened to be there. So that was kind of cool. And here is just a distant shot of all these different, you know, dozens of shorebirds. I think they're plovers. I'm going to go with that for now. Just all they do is just, you can see all their butts because their heads are mostly underwater looking for, you know, whatever underwater things there are, you know, mussels and things like that. Here's a little better view of these birds. Hard to see if they what they catch, but yeah, that's all that they do is just keep, you know. And one other thing I want to say real quick back with that osprey is that it's just amazing. This is what I love about evolution and the life on this planet. I mean, forget about the sheer number of species that evolved from like one single parent species how many billions of years ago, but the fact that we have this flying bird, right, this thing that flies around in the sky and is then able to dive into the water, its wings don't get waterlogged, it's able to catch a fish under the water, it has a third eyelid so that it can see under the water as well, and then it's able to just use its sheer wing strength to lift itself back up out of the water into the air while holding onto the fish, it's like it has four arms, really. Right? The wings, right, kind of like arms in a way. And then it has another pair of arms to hold. And then, you know, it's got to hold on to that. And it's got to fly back up. And it's just amazing that a bird, you know, a thing that flies around, hunts underwater organisms. You just kind of think about it. It's kind of fascinating. So those are the things I think about. All right. So that's the different shorebirds. There you can see a little shorebird butt right there. And this is a, I believe this is a song sparrow. I'm pretty sure. I do my best to identify them. And it's just up on this branch, and it's craning its neck back and just belting out its own little song or call, either to find a mate or for territorial reasons. I don't know which, but and that's what it's doing. Just looks around and then just starts singing and then all the way back and just letting all of it out at the peak of its call, I guess. And then we have a squirrel. I've been trying to photograph things other than birds, and you would think a squirrel would be one of the easiest things to photograph. I don't photograph around where we live because that's not really, I mean, there's buildings and houses and it's not really easy to get a nice, clean, nature-only looking photograph. Not to mention that's too easy. I like the challenge of going out into the, you know, into the wild, so to speak. I mean, I don't live in the mountains of Virginia or the you know, the forest of who knows where, or the jungle. So, you know, I can only get so far. But you would think it would be easy to find a squirrel, but it's really not. So this squirrel was on a tree just off the path, kind of doing its chirr 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 chirr. You know how they do that little, they, you know, yelling at you or letting everyone know that you're around and trying to scare you off or whatever. So that's what it was doing to me. And it's mostly in the shadow, so not the most ideal type of photo, and it's not doing anything exciting, but I had to get at least one photo of a squirrel. I'm still trying to get a photo of a chipmunk. Those are very difficult. And then the last series of photos here are just some turtles. Something about the turtles and their faces. If you take a look at that, they just look so very happy and content. Just, you know, I don't know, I like turtles. I like everything, pretty much. Insects, bugs, reptiles, it doesn't matter. And again, here it is. Another turtle, kind of in the marshy area. Another, like, little kind of stupid grin on its face, so to speak. And a whole bunch of turtles right here, basking, getting that warm sun. That's what I like to do. Do you know that humans are part, our brain, we have a part reptile brain. And sometimes I wonder if that's why we like to bask out in the sun. I mean, I know I do. Sometimes I get sick of it. But I love to just sit out and soak up the sun. And sometimes I wonder if that's because we have that. I mean, we are part reptile when we're born. There's photos out there that you can find that show reptile-like bones that eventually not dissolve, but form into the regular primate bones. I think that's what it was. It wasn't claws or anything. And of course, there's the, yeah, I think it was like reptile-like bones structures in our hands when we develop. I think that's what they found recently. So maybe that's why we also like to, you know, get out in the sun. You know, not that we're reptiles that we need the heat like that. You know, I know why the reptiles, you know, turtles or snakes need to get that sun because they're cold-blooded. But sometimes I feel cold-blooded, and I need to get out in the sun, get moving. But, yeah, and you can see all their little happy faces right there. Just totally happy and content. That's I mean, just, you know, that's all I see when I look at them. Here's a whole gaggle of turtles. I'm not sure what you call a bunch of turtles, but and they're all there, just taking in the sun. There's some more turtles. A few different ages. Age groups there. A young turtle and two mature turtles. And here is a turtle swimming along in the water, the deep water, over in the John Hines refuge. And you can just, I think you can just barely see its shell under there. It looks like you can see like some turtle stripes there that you might see on its shell. But I noticed this poking out of the water, and I thought maybe it's a twig or a stick. But no, it's a happy, another happy little turtle just swimming in the water, and I've never really seen that before. It's just kind of funny to see a turtle swimming. It's something I've not seen. Usually they're sitting around or crawling around on the ground. So that's it for the turtles. Oh no, there's more turtles. Here he's got, so this is one of the very first images that I've, or the days when I was getting used to my lens, kind of still getting used to the settings, little highlights, a little blown out there for not, I wasn't really adjusting for that, and a little bit of blur. Sometimes I would, during this time, I was also, during the first couple weekend or so, I was moving between video, recording video and taking photos, and sometimes I would forget to reset the shutter speed, and I would take pictures at 1/60th of a second, which is good for video, but not good for photos. So there is some slight movement there. You can see some slight blur a little bit, and I think that's why, or it's just out of focus, I don't know, but that's what was going on, switching back and forth and things like that. Here's another happy little turtle just sitting on a log, soaking up the sun. And then the last couple images are some wood ducks. And I don't know why they call them, well, I know why they call them wood ducks, because they nest among trees and wood. But just based on how striking their colors are, I kind of would expect a fancier name than just wood ducks, you know? but there's a female on the left and the male on the right, as it is with most birds. The male is usually more striking color. And this was taken on a separate occasion. I'm not sure if the two wood ducks at the bottom, and these are quite a distance away. So this is another somewhat heavy crop, which kind of explains the somewhat low quality when you zoom in. This pair on the bottom, I'm not sure if they're the same pair that we saw in the previous image. These were taken on separate days. Then we have another solitary wood duck up on the top without a partner, a little bachelor. So I'm not sure if they're maybe, you know, related at all, but who knows. And so that is it for the photos. So thank you very much for tuning in for watching, and I hope you found this to be relaxing, and maybe you got to see some things that, you know, you haven't seen before. I plan to do this type of video every 3 months or so. Like I said, I only go out once on the weekend, not every weekend. You know, all depends on my obligations and things. So we'll see. You know, sometime in the fall, I'll probably do another video like this. In the winter, you know, something like that. So, good luck to you if you, you know, in finding or photographing, whatever it is. If you just go out with your binoculars and you're a birder like that, or you take photos yourself whether you own a long lens or not. And if you're looking for a long lens, a zoom lens, hopefully you can find something in your budget. There are a few decent options out there. And if you don't do either one, have the binoculars or the camera, you always think about picking up an inexpensive pair of binoculars, especially if you're not interested in photographing them, because you get a chance to see them up close and spot them, in the distance, in the trees or whatnot, and you might find yourself enjoying a little, the outdoors a little bit more. Maybe you go out and you go hiking and you just walk around. I'll pick up a $100 pair or even less binoculars, and the next thing you know, you might be out there walking around or hiking and spotting some, cool birds you've never seen before. And, you never know where that might lead. Meeting someone or meeting some friends or a partner yourself, or who knows. All right, so that's going to do it. So again, thanks for tuning in. Thanks for watching. Wish you all my best, and hope to see you in another video real soon. Until then, so long and take care for now.